Everyone, we're pleased to welcome you to our final session of this remarkable colloquium, if we do say so ourselves. This has been a marvelous couple of days, and we're excited for this final colloquium session. I'm going to just, our presenters really don't need much of an introduction to this for this audience, but I'll call attention to them just in order to give you their speaking order and their titles. We'll hear first from Armand Mauss, Professor Emeritus of Sociology at Washington State, more recently affiliated with Claremont Graduate University in California. His title, Acts of Faith and Reason. He'll be followed by Laurel Thatcher Ulrich of Harvard University in their History Department. Can a Mormon write Mormon history? We're all anxiously awaiting that answer. And then we're thrilled to have Claudia Bushman conclude in terms of speakers' presentations, My Life Among the Scholars. Grant Wacker, Emeritus of the Duke Divinity School, will comment on those presentations. Grant is most recently writing the high of what can only be described as a triumphant Smith Pettit lecture at the Mormon History Association with a remarkable standing ovation from that audience. That was a moment. He had that crowd eating out of his hand. It was a great talk. If you missed it, you'll be able to read it later. We'll go in that order, and then we'll go from there. Armand, to you.
Like my colleagues here, I've been honored by the invitation to participate in this great event in Richard's honor. Among the instructions given to the participants in this festschrift were that we should reflect on such questions as how Mormonism has informed the scholarship, teachings, and lines of inquiry chosen for our work, what challenges and tensions these choices have presented, and how our work has complicated some key relationships. Having listened to the earlier presentations, however, I've had cause to wonder if I might have misunderstood the intended focus of our respective contributions, which I took to be a focus more upon our personal intellectual struggles and issues than upon theoretical abstractions in historiography and the like. So my focus today is quite personal. Of the books and articles that I have published on Mormons during the past several decades, I think my experiences with two of my books in particular would typify and suggest some answers to these questions in my career. These books were The Angel and the Beehive and All Abraham's Children. Both were published by the University of Illinois Press. Both received prizes from the Mormon History Association. Both were also the products of ongoing negotiations across time between my identity as a Mormon and my identity as a secular scholar, or if you will, negotiations between faith and intellect. More recently, in working on a memoir about precisely these same negotiations throughout my career, I was reminded of the hazards in retrospective constructions of important autobiographical experiences, even with the help of good documentation. So I proceed with some trepidation. As I began my college education, I remember having had a strong apologetic bent toward all things Mormon, a tendency that stayed with me even as I began my graduate work at UC Berkeley. I think it had pretty well worn off by the time I finished my doctoral work, But even now, I sometimes wonder if one or another of the explanations I have used in my books and articles on the Mormon experience might have originated, however unintentionally, in an apologetic impulse. Certainly by the middle years of my academic career, it had become my intention to avoid even the appearance of apologetics as an organizing framework for my work. Yet in trying to do so, I have also wanted to avoid the other extreme of foreclosing the possibility of divine intervention or of any other apologetic construction as alternative or concomitant explanations for historical developments in the Mormon experience. For example, in some of my work, especially in my Angel and Beehive, I have favored a kind of natural history theoretical model in which developments in the LDS church and culture during the second half of the 20th century are explained mainly as evolving through normal organizational responses to events in the American social and political environment. Such an explanation does not rule out divine intervention as the ultimate source of any decisions made in those organizational responses, but it simply leaves such intervention moot. Similarly, in All Abraham's Children, I interpret the changing LDS understandings and policies about the various races or ethnic groups as the products of changing organizational imperatives across time, fully understandable, without the need to cite divine intervention in explaining either the origin or the demise of the LDS racialist heritage, though to be sure many LDS believers do continue to cite divine intervention. The Angel and the Beehive was the combined product of scholarly curiosity and personal religious discontent. My upbringing and young adult years had occurred during the Americanization period in Mormon history. While a certain institutional defensiveness remained about the historical scandals and peculiarities sometimes haunting the public perception of the church and its members, institutional policies of the church in those years generally favored rapid assimilation into normal American respectability. Increasingly, the Mormon way of life converged with the American way. And even the doctrines and scriptures selectively emphasized in Mormon teaching tended to complement rather than to challenge the conventional Protestant American preferences. Then, beginning in the 1960s and increasingly thereafter, the church began to modify its assimilationist posture in favor of recovering and re-emphasizing some of the doctrines and policies from its more radical past, and to enforce them through a centralized organizational scheme called correlation. I came to refer to this changed ecclesiastical culture as retrenchment, and it made my religious life seem quite different and much less comfortable than the one in which I had grown up and served my mission. I needed to understand what was happening and why. Meanwhile, in my graduate work, I encountered the conventional explanations from social science about the nature of religion, the understanding of all realities as socially constructed, and the natural and typical changes in religious movements as they are gradually transformed from radical sects into assimilated and respectable churches. While such sect-to-church transitions historically seemed always to go in the same direction, it remained theoretically possible for this process to reverse itself at some point, so that a given religious movement, for its own purposes, might turn away from assimilation and begin to recover some of its earlier sect-like traits. The literature offered no specific examples of this kind of reversal. But as I saw what was happening in my own religious experience, it seemed to me that Mormonism was just such an example. As I investigated this prospect, I found ample empirical evidence of this retrenchment in LDS doctrine and scripture, pedagogy, family policies, missionary enterprise, a renewed emphasis on genealogy and temples. A more or less natural concomitant of all this was also a greatly reduced official tolerance for independent intellectual expressions and publications among the members. The initial incentive for putting together a general theory about all this occurred when I was invited to give one of the Red Center lectures at BYU, and the book, Angel and Beehive, came directly out of that fortuitous occasion a few years later. Certain elements in that Red lecture proved somewhat contentious when the BYU Alumni Magazine undertook to publish it, eventually requiring some cuts and ultimate clearance directly from BYU President Jeffrey Holland before it could be published. Rather an ironic illustration of the retrenchment policy itself. From the 1960s through the 1990s, indeed, the retrenchment process was not merely a scholarly abstraction for me, for it occurred in concrete and personal forms in my own life and in the lives of my wife and children, in the wards and stakes where we lived. We saw it in the pedagogy of the high school seminary program, in the policies relating to women's roles and family obligations, in the content of the Relief Society curriculum, in the renewed emphasis upon the Book of Mormon, and in a new urgency about following the prophet. I felt it personally on several occasions when I was summoned by my stake president, on orders from above, to explain some of my scholarly publications or lectures on Mormon subjects. In all of these various manifestations of retrenchment, my faith was sometimes tested. But ultimately that faith, or at least my loyalty to the church, found an ally in my sociological understanding. For I realized that what was happening was essentially an impersonal process originating in well-intentioned policies, even if I didn't like them. I could either walk away or stay and try to help my family and others to understand and deal with the retrenchment process until it had run its course and the pendulum had begun to swing back in the other direction. Obviously, I stayed. And the retrenchment eventually did indeed begin to wane or even retreat somewhat. The other book, All Abraham's Children, had quite a different origin, one that derived from my efforts to understand and explain the traditional LDS policies toward African Americans. The project began with my doctoral dissertation, comparing the consequences of LDS teachings about African Americans with LDS teachings about Jews. When the project reached its final form, some three decades later, it turned out to be a book on the origin and consequences of the Mormon racialist heritage more generally, involving not only blacks and Jews, but also American Aboriginal peoples, or Indians, plus the construction and implications of a superior ethnic identity for Euro-American Mormons themselves. During that entire period, of course, the LDS church policies and teachings toward all of these various ethnic identities were gradually evolving, with the eventual outcome that the ethnic and racial heritage of potential converts came to be understood as totally irrelevant in determining either the access to all salvific rituals or the to our eternal destinies. All peoples truly and finally could become Abraham's children, as Paul had promised the Galatians. It must be remembered that my research and writing on such race-related questions occurred during that same retrenchment period analyzed in my earlier book. It was also, as things turned out, a period of great sensitivity both in the nation and in the church about racial and ethnic differences and their various implications. In academia and in the mass media, there was little tolerance for actual or perceived racial discrimination based on religious doctrines or policies, especially in the social sciences and especially on the Berkeley campus. The LDS leadership, for its part, seemed divided over how best to resolve its paradoxical teachings and policies, not only in relation to people of African descent, but even in its policies toward American Indians, where a long-standing and well-intentioned integration program was unraveling toward eventual termination. Among the leaders, as well as in the Mormon rank and file, there was little appreciation for the unsponsored and unapproved publications of pesky intellectuals on racial issues. Many of us felt the pressures from such disapproval in one form or another. However, significant changes during recent years in church narratives and policies toward blacks, as well as toward certain other ethnic peoples, have left me feeling a degree of vindication and have reinforced my faith that perhaps divine revelation can eventually break through even the most entrenched cultural traditions. In summary, Mormonism has been a formative influence in my scholarship in general, but especially in two main lines of inquiry. One, the development of late 20th century LDS ecclesiastical culture, and two, the changing Mormon conceptions about race and lineage. Derivatively, my university teaching in the sociology of religion has been informed by my study of new religious movements more generally, especially in offering a comparative context for the study of Mormons and Mormonism. The tensions and complications presented by these career choices have occurred mainly with local and general church leaders and members who have found it difficult to reconcile my academic approach in religious studies with the more devotional approach so familiar to them. My chief resort in dealing with the resulting challenges has been a continuing effort to educate church members and leaders about the value and complementarity of both approaches, academic and devotional. An essay from an earlier conference on the work of Richard Bushman characterized his work as reflecting the hermeneutics of generosity. Maybe my work on the LDS church and religion could be characterized similarly, but I'm not so sure. In general, my interpretations of LDS historical developments have tended to assume that decision-making among church leaders is typically well-intentioned and guided by fiduciary impulses, whatever the apparent outcomes of those decisions. And that the general membership, too, has usually tried to act in accordance with its religious commitments, if often imperfectly. Yet I have also tended to use interpretive frameworks which de-emphasize the intentionality of individual actors in favor of collective processes and unintended consequences over which church leaders and members have very limited control. Such a framework neither invokes divine influences nor rules them out, nor even explicitly brackets them. neither does it rule out consideration of forgotten alternatives in human decision-making at either the individual or the collective level. Of course, any theoretical framework, and not just those of an apologetic kind, run the risk of bias in their very construction, not merely in the selectivity or manipulation of the data that they bring to bear. Indeed, all of these risks must be taken into account even in considering the autobiographical reconstruction I have just offered here about my own scholarship more generally. Caveat lector, let the reader beware. Thank you.
Can a Mormon write Mormon history? At first glance, that is really a silly question. Here we are. The room is full of us. Can a Catholic write about Catholics? A Jew about Jews? An African American about African Americans? A woman about women? Or a man about men? To assume that Mormons have special problems in the academy is at one level insulting, both to Mormons and to the academy. And thank goodness no one has assumed that in the last day and a half that we've been talking about it. That kind of assumption implies that there's something inherent in our faith that makes it difficult to exercise professional standards, that practicing or believing Latter-day Saints are incapable of fidelity to evidence, unwilling to consider alternative explanations for religious phenomena, or closed to new ways of thinking. Well, there are people who think like that. I am thinking of that remarkable review of Rough Stone Rolling by Larry McMurdy, when he compared a belief in Mormonism to a belief in Santa Claus and dismissed Richard Bushman's scholarship and said Von Brody had said all that needed to be said. Fortunately, that is an example, I think we would probably agree, of ignorance or maybe an unwillingness to read the book he was reviewing. But that question, can Mormons write Mormon history, is a really interesting one, as we've discovered over these last hours. It is a question that is connected to really large issues in the academy and also in contemporary and late 20th century politics. We've paid a lot of attention to the philosophical and historiographical issues. I think we haven't paid as much attention as we might have to the really practical and perhaps intellectual or institutional dimensions of our topic. We haven't thought a lot about how this question about Mormonism in the academy really reflects and is part of a larger concern about identity, identity in the academy. It's not just about postmodernism. It's about the civil rights movement. It's about the women's movement. It's about the people who are in the academy, who are not all white males. And increasingly, that population has been transformed. So Mormon scholars have not only been accountable in this process to their fellow academics, but to their fellow believers and to the institutional church. And so I've decided to just reflect, because we were invited to do so, in a fairly personal way, about some of these issues, and you will not be surprised to know that the issue that I have wanted to reflect on here really is the issue about gender and women's history, those two themes. Who do we write about in history, and who writes history? When I passed my PhD exams at the University of New Hampshire in 1976 and began thinking about a dissertation topic, I worried about doing the very thing I most wanted to do, which was to write women's history. I thought about writing about Mormon women because I had participated in the remarkable process led by our last speaker, Claudia Bushman, my good friend, in the book Mormon Sisters and in eventually the founding of Exponent 2. But I was in New Hampshire. I had five children. I was a faculty wife. I was not very mobile, and there was no one at the University of New Hampshire could have mentored that kind of a project. So I became an early American historian, Richard Bushman's other field. And I will say, as I was struggling with this decision, Richard said, now this was passed on via Claudia, that I should not get a PhD because it would spoil my style. Well, I took that as a compliment on my writing, not as a put down. And I will say, when I didn't follow that advice, Richard was a great booster of my work and a great exemplar as well. Well, what was I going to write about? Could I write about women at some level? And if I did so, would I be marginalizing myself in the academy? And so I said to my mentor, Charles Clark, if I write about women, will I be confining myself to women's division? And he looked kind of puzzled. And I was alluding to something very real in my own life experience, which I later explained to him. I grew up in the household of debaters. People used to joke, you didn't join the Thatcher family, they said to my husband when we were engaged. You're joining the Thatcher debating society. My father had participated in intercollegiate debate when he was a student at the University of Utah. And he always made sure that our little rural Idaho school had somebody to coach the debate team. And among my most vivid and warm memories of my high school years are getting up at 6 a.m. to practice the piano. I was a very dutiful young woman. Practice the piano before going to school early to practice with the debate team. My mother slept in, and it was my father who made breakfast for the two of us. And he sometimes listened to my speeches and gave me some good advice. I modeled myself on my older brother, Gordon, who, though 7 years older, had really been a kind of model for me. He was a champion debater in high school and college, and later won moot court competitions in law school. My younger sister later became my partner. But in high school, males and females debated together against each other and on the same team. So I was quite shocked when I got to the University of Utah in 1956 to discover that there were no co-ed debate teams at the U. And apparently at any of the other schools in the Western Speech Association. George Adamson, our debate coach, enforced that rule rigorously. And he said that allowing women to compete against men would be unfair. Judges would always favor the women. And so there was women's division and men's division in speech and in debate. And I will say, I won a lot of trophies, always in women's division. So when I said to Charles Clark, am I consigning myself to women's division? That was a mark of my transformation, because in college, I wouldn't have had that consciousness. But I had achieved a kind of feminist consciousness through David Hall's dissertation students that he talked about yesterday. Through my friendship with Claudia Bushman, I was kind of folded into that support group and got to know them. And I was really learning to critique the kind of well-meaning concept of separatism that George Adamson recommended. So I said, Charlie, am I consigning myself to women's division? And he laughed. He thought that must be about Mormonism. No, 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 that's not about Mormonism. Utah, University of Utah is a state school. You know, I didn't want to go there. He told me that it made perfect sense to write about what I cared about. He had been a journalist before becoming a historian and was then writing a book on early American newspapers. I was a housewife and a mother. Surely I could capitalize on that by writing about good wives in northern New England from 1650 to 1750, which is what I did in my dissertation. Had I been at a major research institution, I doubt that I would have received the same advice. Many women have told me then and later that they were told the last thing they could do is write about women's history if they wanted to have a job. It was, of course, feminists who taught us that the personal is political. So it is perhaps not surprising that an academic field that developed in the wake of feminist activism seems suspect, particularly among male academics who believed that academic standards were neutral, objective, and that when women and racial minorities prove themselves worthy, they would rise within the profession. Of course, few of them recognize the way that their own life experiences and biases had shaped that assumption. So to work in that field from the very beginning meant to engage the personal, the political, and the academic. And it has been a challenge and a delight and a fascination and a growing experience. As I look back on my career, I tried to remember how much support and mentoring I received from men who were either bemused or hostile to feminism. My own father, for example, who later in life in the 70s, as the women's movement developed, who are these women who want to be men? It never would have occurred to him that teaching his daughter to debate had in any way encouraged such behavior. And of course, he always wanted me to use my maiden name as my middle name so everybody would know I was his daughter. At UNH, I had two dissertation advisors. One was both social historians, but very, very different. One quantifier, one narrative historian. And they both supported me. I suspect they did so, not only because I was a good student, but because they thought they had nothing, I had nothing to lose, and they had nothing to lose because I was a faculty wife and was unlikely to enter the job market. In fact, that was the assumption. At the celebration dinner after I successfully defended my dissertation, one of my mentors, the quantifier, those who know who I'm talking about, said as much, arguing that for male students, getting a job was a source of identity in a way it could not be for me. The two women at the table were horrified. Number of years ago, historian Joanne Myrovitz published a fascinating analysis of the emergence of feminism in the 1960s based on reading the very same periodicals that Betty Friedan had used in her landmark book, The Feminine Mystique. Meyerowitz argued that the response, the really explosive response to Friedan, was not triggered by rampant sexism in the 1950s, so much as by a kind of double thinking that assumed equality between men and women and encouraged female achievement, and at the same time accepted the notion that adult women would spend most of their lives as wives and mothers. It's how I was raised, to be a high achiever, academically achievement, and it just never occurred to me to question the fact that almost all of my teachers in college were male, and that the three female, and there were only three, were all single. I loved school, I respected home and motherhood. I had no idea that social arrangements would make it extremely difficult for me to continue developing my gifts as a human being alongside my responsibilities as a wife and mother. I blissfully assumed that once I had my BA and my MRS, all other steps would unfold magically. It took me about 6 months after my first child was born to recognize that something had been missing in my education. My decision 15 years later to write a dissertation in women's history was in one sense foreordained. I was in a PhD program in part because of my involvement with other LDS women who were attempting to rethink the position of women in the church and who had found validation from the study of history, particularly the discovery of their pioneer foremothers who were doing things we had never thought of. But it was also, and particularly the way I wrote about those women in the 17th and 18th century, an outgrowth of my own experience as a housewife, a mother, a PTA worker, a sense of the value of those anonymous women that Virginia Woolf talked about, the women I mentioned in my first published scholarly article, and where I wrote that fateful sentence that you all know about. I explained all this in the introduction to the book I wrote about that strange slogan and about the tension in the larger field of history between the self-assertion nourished by feminism and the rediscovery of the ordinary by social historians and feminist scholars. And those themes all came together, my Mormonism, my training as a social historian, and my feminism. When the Journal of American History asked me to participate in a forum on self and subject, I explained that as a writer, I had lived two lives, as a professional historian and as a personal essayist, and that most of my personal essays had been written for Latter-day Saint readers. Recently, a literary scholar stunned me by coming to interview me and then confessing she had read everything I had ever written. She had dug up all those personal essays in Dialogue and Exponent in All Dodd's Critters, in other places, in Weber's Studies. I mean, she had been very industrious. She was very smitten by a midwife's tale, but she became very curious about its author. And she wrote a very long description of Laurel Ulrich that was pretty stunning. She got inside my head. And she argued that my personal essays help us to understand her academic work and to understand its productively oxymoronic quality. Now, I had called myself an oxymoron in one of my essays, and she had built on that idea. She wrote that she found in my early essays a heartfelt sense of mission, namely, reconciling intellectual endeavor, political advocacy, and religious faith. It was a little strange to have somebody do that. For me, this personally is a powerful demonstration of a by now obvious point. Scholars are people too. But we are also scholars. I am not about to abandon the idea that the skills we learn through academic study are not only essential to our professional work, they become, whether we intend it or not, part of our personal identities. That may be one reason why I'm uncomfortable with the notion that Mormons should be obligated to account for their religious affiliation in any explicit way in order to write Mormon history. It seems clear to me that our inner selves will emerge in our work whether or not we intend it. That doesn't mean that writing about very topics very close to our own experience or faith is an easy job. Writing history is hard work. It is always a dialogue between present and past and between self and subject. But as my father taught me, a good debater knows how to argue on both sides of the question, and I am grateful for that.
I very much enjoyed this conference so far. It's been very interesting to me to see people that I knew many years ago and how they've developed and what's come along. It's been just a very interesting experience. And I want to, as everyone has, thank Spencer for putting it all together. And I think this wonderful conference bodes well for his future as the leader of the Maxwell Institute. Spencer. Yeah. So it's been a pleasure to see old friends and new friends, and I've been particularly grateful that I have 2/3 of my children here, that is 4 of 6, plus 3 spouses, plus a good selection of grandchildren. And that's been wonderful for me to have them here so they could hear nice things said about their grandfather, which he certainly deserves. So, Richard, that's for you. So, and thanks to all of you for coming. It's been wonderful to see you again. Now, how does being a Mormon influence my teaching and scholarship? Well, I have had such a strange teaching career that my opinions on this subject have very little relevance. I was late and a long-time graduate student who did not begin my doctoral studies until I had 5 children. And then I spent my working years as the wife of, moving frequently, never going on the market or actually applying for a job. No one ever depended on me for food, to provide their bread. I've always been a scholar for fun and entertainment, and also pain and misery, rather than for fame, fortune, or food. I teach and I have taught and I write books because that's what I do. Because of my tenuous status, I never really identified with the academic life. I'm an outlier. I'm finishing up this conference not because of my academic record, but because of my identity as the wife of. But I do have a few things to say. One of my best lifetime stories is that I graduated from college in maternity clothes, that I began my master's degree when we could afford some tuition for me with 2 children and finished with 3. I began my PhD work with 5 children and finished with 6. That was a long time ago when things were very different. Nobody ever encouraged me to go to graduate school. My MA advisor never had time to talk to me because I wasn't a real student. He was shuttered in his office with real students, weeping undergraduates. When I applied for a doctoral program, the English department chair said to me in consternation, "Oh, Mrs. Bushman, why don't you just stay home and take care of your children?" So why did I do it? Well, I was bored. I kept house and I tended my children. I read a lot, but I had nothing to lay my mind on. As a housewife in those days, I had no status, no respect. I had no sense of progress. My husband had a new life as a graduate student and then as a young professor, with lots of compelling friends, new discoveries and opportunities. He had no time for me. He had no interest in me. I had nothing to say of any interest. I had no conversation. All I could see ahead was endless household chores. Going to work was unthinkable then. Certainly not desirable. I had too much work to do at home. What to do? I went back to school. And I was very fortunate to land in David Hall's AMNESP program. That's the American and New England Studies program. David taught us that the only important things that ever happened in the United States happened in New England. And we believed it, too. We believed it. But that was a magnificent program, opening up new worlds to me, worlds that I continue to inhabit to my great pleasure. It's a great experience. At that time, Richard was very helpful about lots of things, advising me, discussing paper topics, talking ideas and books. My classes became extensions for him, and he became my great teacher. Eventually, we collaborated on a few projects. We've always read and edited each other's works and been mutually helpful. I think I was always smart enough, but I never really got it in school. At my high school, it was the cool thing to be disdainful of study and learning. I did accidentally get all A's my freshman year in high school, but I took care not to let that happen again. It was so uncool. I did get into some very good colleges, but that was a long time ago and almost a fluke. My guidance counselor gave me some excellent advice, and I just took it. I was voted most likely to succeed at my high school graduation, but I thought that was an insult. I would much have preferred to have been the best dancer or had the best hair. But to get to the subject, how has my Mormonness influenced my teaching? In my case, how does it not? I'm such a Mormon, a so deeply encased third and fourth generation of Latter-day Saints, with grandparents from four different countries who met and married in Utah. They would never have met without the church. I would never have existed as I am without the church. How could my whole life not be deeply influenced by the church? I even have a Mormon convert great-great-grandfather who joined the church and came to Utah in the 1850s and then apostatized. He fled from Utah in the dark of night, lest he be apprehended by Brigham Young or some of his men. My experience includes being forbidden to teach class because I was a Mormon. I was an early student of women's studies and was teaching a class on the history of women in the United States for a school's honor program. The women's studies program refused to cross-list the class because I was a Mormon and so unqualified to teach the subject. That was a pretty horrendous crisis for me, but I eventually managed to reinvent myself as a local and public historian, teaching classes about my town and state, beginning a local historical society with my students, and eventually getting a real job as the director of a state agency that celebrated things. I had a great time doing that. Discipline drift and shifting emphasis is common for scholars like me. I've always been a tenuous academic. I hang on by my fingernails to the academic life until I fall off. Then I get a little purchase and I hang on for a while again. Many years ago, I was teaching freshman English when I began to expect my fourth child. I was then told that I could teach no more. Don't want any of those mothers of many children. But as to my church membership, what is important to me is that I see the classroom as a place of democratic rather than aristocratic leadership. Anybody can teach a class, and everyone does, including me from an early age. In the church, we believe that we are all equal, except for some distant leaders, and we are all above average. I've never flunked a student, and I practiced grade inflation before it was popular. I think that once a student has been admitted to a program, all involved should help him get through. Flunking out graduate students 2 or 3 years along the way seems terrible to me, defining them as lifelong failures. I did once have a student in a freshman composition course, a football player who was pretty obviously plagiarizing his papers. His own weren't very good, and the substitutes were pretty bad too. But I called him in and I said that I knew these were not his papers, but I didn't want to have to try to prove he was a cheater. I said I would not turn him in if the rest of his papers sounded as if he had written them. They pretty much did. He passed the course. And I feel the same way about subject matter. I don't actually think I have much to teach students, but I do think I can put them into environments where they can teach themselves something, and the things that the person learns himself are much more memorable and useful than those that he gets when someone lectures at him. So the effort is to get a student to read some document or other, ask some kind of question, and then get him to formulate an oral or written answer. I don't think anyone knows what she thinks until she has to say it or write it down and expand on it and defend it and generally make it her own. But I was very slow to learn that principle. I spent 4 years at a very good college where the professors tried to get me to think of answers to the questions they posed and to speak or write them, and I wanted none of it. My ingrained experience from high school led me to say, just tell me what is going on here. What is this all about? I'll write it down in my notes and learn it. I don't want to hear the puerile comments of my fellow students. I don't want class discussions. I wanted lectures. It took me a long time to change my mind as to what a real education consisted of. I believe that knowledge and learning start at the bottom level. The individual experience is the basis of history. The individual story is the basis of literature. The one is the important unit, and that's why I love autobiography and oral history, why I think that everyone should write daily in a journal. Individual experience is the important unit to me, and that goes with my mistrusting the big ideas of history and literature. Those change. They differ from age to age. They are interesting to discuss, but they don't last. The careful or accidental arrangement of words on paper by a single individual does last. That is what she wrote, the way she wrote it. That's privileged for me over the interpretation of some later scholar. I encourage more individual writing. Another reason I think that students should be treated generously and individually is that I'm really a religious universalist. I think everyone will be saved. I think that some move through the system more quickly than others, but I can't believe that a third of the host of heaven was just discarded. I think that they went into some remedial program and then were shipped off and are now peopling other earths and working out their salvation somewhere else. I even have my doubts about the sons of perdition. They're important players in the scheme of things, and certainly spirits of merit and ability. They too will be saved. My view is one of total Mormon optimism. There's no beginning, there is no end, and we're all in the business of getting better and better. We are not all getting more and more success, but we are certainly getting more and more experience. I believe that there will be success ahead and that everything will work out. Last year, thanks to the recommendation of Richard Brown, recently on this program, Richard and I were invited to be senior scholars at the American Antiquarian Society, a magnificent collection of documents that date primarily to 1876, when the Library of Congress took over. And we were invited to be there to do our own work. And one of the things that senior long-term scholars do at the Antiquarian Society is to involve the short-term fellows in social experiences, which experiences generally include alcohol. But we just don't do alcohol. Grateful that I am that alcohol is not a part of my life, and that with my addictive personality, I am thus prevented from the problems of its overuse, I still don't think of it as more evil than other potentially addictive substances. But I do see it as a major marker. And as it is such a marker, I do not ignore the boundary. So I don't drink alcohol, not even at all. I was at a very elegant dinner recently when a Frenchman sitting next to me noted that I was not drinking and asked if I knew that in a number of civilizations, it was considered very disrespectful not to drink with your companions. I said I knew that, and that I wanted him to know that I was not offended that he was not drinking with me. Whereupon, he turned away and did not speak to me for the rest of the dinner. I had identified myself in his eyes as an uncivilized boor. But I didn't think that he looked very good either. What we did at the Antiquarian Society was to have lunches for 6 or 8 people every couple of weeks or so. Guests were always very gracious and appreciative, but I knew very well that they would have preferred a happy hour every Friday afternoon. Maybe we should be more open to the preferences of others, I say. We always consider it, but then we decide against it. It's not that I consider drinking or serving alcohol a terrible thing to do. It's just that we're Mormons and we don't do that. As to scholarship, I know that my choices are informed by my Mormonness. I don't like to write. I don't like to do research. I occasionally enjoy reading a monograph for a few chapters, but I'd much rather read fiction, particularly 19th century novels, than history. I don't like to write, but I've written quite a bit. My CV lists a number of books and quite a few articles. I've been at it for a long time, and what I am doing is writing my own personal scriptures. A couple of the books are edited documents, a couple are edited essays, but there are some very long and serious books over which I struggled for many years, but they are all autobiography. I'm writing my own story. Someone would have to know me pretty well to see all the relationships and justify the choices, but they're all there. Like the voyages of explorers to other continents, I have discovered and been drawn to my topics and made them my own. They are all my extended story, additional and alternative worlds that I appropriate and colonize. On this occasion, it is probably worth doing to comment on my and our most recent and potentially final teaching experience when Richard and I co-taught a class on contemporary Mormonism. This was an undergraduate seminar at Columbia University meant for 15 students. The idea came from a book of that name I had written fairly recently, and the idea was to talk about the church today rather than beginning with Joseph Smith, the gold plates, the trek west, and so on. The class was wildly popular, filling the first day with a wide variety of religion majors and practitioners of various stripes, Catholics, Protestants, Jews, agnostics, former and closet Mormons, people who had known Mormons before. There were to be just 15 students, but we eventually took 20 and had a number of auditors as well. We were absolutely open and straight about all topics. Gone were all the traditional pieties that such classes have included in the past. We invited in a number of guest speakers, such as the bishop, the temple president, the missionaries, the gay man, male and female bedrock types, inactives, etc., etc. They made brief presentations and then answered all questions, volunteering such unknown information about themselves as previous disfellowshippings, excommunications, being sent home from missions, to our very great surprise. The students were required to attend a 3-hour church service, which they survived after much trepidation. It was all a great experience, bringing the gospel and the classroom so close together. The class made a fitting conclusion to a life of sporadic Mormon-influenced teaching and of living Mormonism itself. That's where I'll start in another life. Thank you.
Thank you all. Like the others, I want to begin with a heartfelt gratitude to Spencer and to Kathleen and to Jed and for Jeremy for his magnificent organization of all the details. This really is a big honor, and it's also a great pleasure. This natural scenery is just delightful for a boy from North Carolina. We have lots of trees, but we don't have mountains like this, so it's really great. When I think about my position here, I try not to, actually, because I am responding to papers from three of the most distinguished scholars in the nation, and I'm also the final speaker. And it brings to mind an experience I had about, actually, 20 years ago, still in my mind. Our younger daughter was about 10 years old, and she was sitting at the kitchen table having breakfast, and I came walking in with a satchel, and she said, "Are you going away, Papa?" And yeah, I had forgot to tell her, and she said, "Well, where are you going?" And I said, "Well, actually, I'm going to California." "Well, what are you going to do there?" And I said, "Well, I'm going to give a talk." "But what about?" And I said, "Well, in this case, I'm going to talk about the rise of the Christian right." And there's a long pause, and she said, "Papa, do you know that much?" So I have that worry right now. Do I know enough to be able to respond to these absolutely wonderful, delightful papers? I have to tell you all that as I read them, I read passages to my wife, and I very rarely do that when I'm invited to respond to papers, and she thought they were delightful too. We all agreed that we would do first names because we've become friends in these days, so I will do that. In his very thought-filled paper, Armand raises three significant issues that I want to note. First, he tells us that he started college with an apologetic interest in Mormon studies, but by the time he finished his doctoral work at UC Berkeley, he had developed what he calls a natural history theoretical model of social process. Which is to say, he did not presuppose that divine influence either did or did not play a role. He simply set that question aside. He would focus on data available to anyone and invoke explanatory frameworks available to anyone of whatever faith or none. The historian George Marsden calls this approach methodological agnosticism. Now, I suspect that natural history method, with Armand's words, or methodological agnosticism, is the approach that almost all believers adopt for their academic work if they expect to be read outside church circles, or for that matter, to get your PhD from UC Berkeley. And here it is also worth noting an additional point, and that is that natural history method was not simply an intellectual principle, but also a political judgment. The only way for multiple groups with multiple outlooks to get along in the university was to move onto this neutral territory. There's one other point that flows from this one, and that is the role of audience. Yesterday, Laurie Maffley Kipp raised this question. Audiences matter. Are we writing for doctoral advisors? Are we writing for university press editors? Are we writing for church leaders or for individual members? Are we writing for our families? These are important issues, and Armand's paper implies them and raises those questions. A second point worth noting, and I don't think he read this, forgive me if you did, but it's in the original draft. A second point worth noting is Armand's suspicion that, contrary to his best intentions, his natural history method still might have borne apologetic premises and results. Now, what this suggests is that natural history methods are easier claimed than executed. As all three of these papers attest, both explicitly and implicitly, we are whole persons. We cannot be broken up and sorted into tidy boxes labeled sacred, secular, and methodologically agnostic. Who we are in private inevitably influences who we are in public, including the public university classroom. It shapes the data we think are relevant. It shapes the warrants we think are credible, and it shapes the conclusions we think are persuasive. I'll say more about this later. The third issue is Armand's refreshing claim that natural history methods actually helped him come to peace with a Mormon retreat from the assimilationist ideals that he had grown up with. He came to understand this retreat, which he calls retrenchment, as an impersonal process that was characteristic of most large-scale organizations. He may have been the victim of retrenchment, but he certainly was not the target. Now, I say that this claim is refreshing because believer academics usually say that the encounter with natural history methods was either an unsettling process, if you wanted to preserve your tradition, or it was an exhilarating process for those who wanted to free themselves from the shackles of their tradition. Armand's route is different. He described it as helpful rather than unsettling or exhilarating. And I think this is a path that many Christian academics follow, and it's received far too little attention. Laurel moves in a different direction, comparing Latter-day Saint identity with gender identity. Her story is rich with ironies. At the University of Utah, she remembers the free forum of college debate proved not free at all, but restricted by gender. At the University of New Hampshire, male mentors encouraged her interest in the history of marriage and motherhood, but they assumed she had nothing to lose since she probably would not go on the job market anyway. The ironies continue. If she had finished her doctoral work at a major research institution, she suspects, her advisors would have tried to deflect her historical interest in the daily lives of wives and mothers because that topic was supposedly too narrow and too political. Now, Laurel is too kind to say so, but I will, say that I suspect they would have assumed that their own fields were broadly based and antiseptically free of identity politics. Now, Laurel's academic work, or maybe I should, certainly I should call it academic fame. She has, after all, won a Pulitzer Prize and a Bancroft Prize. And I would add that I have never met a person who has won both a Pulitzer Prize and a Bancroft Prize, but I have shaken her hand, and so you can shake my hand later, and so we can all absorb the fame. Laurel's academic work rests on University Press books, so she paid her dues to the Secular Academy. She followed its rules about evidence, warrant, conclusion, and good writing. Those books explored aspects of American culture associated with the feminine sphere, sexuality, childbirth, mothering, housekeeping, community service, areas once considered narrow and political. But notice, they came from the same pen that also wrote personal essays designed for Latter-day Saint readers, the unsponsored sector, as she calls it in another publication. So she led two lives. Even so, they were not two distinct lives, but one life with different emphases. She writes, "Our inner selves will emerge in our work, whether or not we intend it." We often think of history as a conversation with the past and present, but it is also a conversation with the self and the subject. That's a fabulous line. I love it. I probably will plagiarize it sooner or later. A conversation with the self and the subject. Now, all of this I find very persuasive, but I confess that I am puzzled by another one of Laurel's statements. She says, "I am uncomfortable with the notion that Mormons should be obligated to account for their religious affiliation in order to write Mormon history." Now, insofar as that statement challenges the notion, often entertained in the elite academy, especially by male members, that the standards of excellence are identity-free, I heartily agree with that. But I confess that I am uneasy with her claim, if I understand it rightly, that in the academy, Latter-day Saint identity and women's identity are similar. The results of marginalization might be the same, but not the roots. LDS identity rests on a foundation of supernatural revelation outside ordinary history, while women's identity rests squarely within ordinary history. Now, I hasten to say it is, of course, possible to write Mormon history or Pentecostal history or Adventist history in a way that passes the litmus tests imposed by the Secular Academy and by university presses. And most of us have done that. And that certainly is true when we are dealing with mundane affairs, what we might call conversations around the supper table. And that surely is the vast majority of what one would want to write about Mormonism or Pentecostalism or whatever. Nonetheless, at the end of the day, one has to suspend providential or miraculous causal claims and render them either explicitly or implicitly in the historical mode. I can write in the New York Times that Joseph Smith thought that angelic beings visited him, and I can write that his friends and family thought so too, but I cannot write in the first person singular that forces outside history played a role in history and then leave it there as if that is an acceptable explanation in the public marketplace of ideas. I would love to hear what Laurel has to think of this issue. In an astute review of Richard Bushman's Joseph Smith, Laurie Maffley Kipp asks, whether it is even possible to write a biography of Joseph Smith that is persuasive to both believers and non-believers. Laurie does not answer her question directly, but she adds, Bushman edges about as close to the divide as he possibly can. I agree. And I would add that But I would add that edging close is not the same as crossing over. I believe that many believer academics, including me, hope that that divide remains. And I hope that it remains there uncrossable. These are very interesting, tangled issues that were addressed in the previous session. And again, I'd love to hear Laurel's thoughts on this matter. Claudia Bushman's delightful paper highlights a different kind of tension. This is the one between the non-professional and the professional scholar. I've always been a scholar for fun and entertainment and also pain and misery rather than for fame, fortune, or food, she writes. Because of my tenuous status, I have never really identified with the academic life. I am always an outlier. Well, first we should note the whimsical juxtaposition of fun and entertainment and also pain and misery on one hand with fame, fortune, or food on the other hand. I'm pretty sure that this juxtaposition is at least to some extent a spoof, since there is an awful lot of overlap. Professional scholarship is often fun, and heaven knows it often involves pain and misery when we see it in the subjects we write about and when we await the verdict on our own 10-year decision. A lot of anxiety there. And non-professionals can become very famous and make a very good living from history writing, too. I think this is whimsical, but it's delightful. The second and main point is Claudia's experience of being a woman academic, and even more a Mormon woman academic, in a secular university environment that assumed that her primary identity would be in the home and the Sunday school. The university's discomfort with the notion of cognitive or propositional revelation, which lies at the heart of Mormon theology, was not the issue here. Rather, the issue was the cultural stereotype that women's true vocation lay outside the academy. They were free to join the conversation, but only as non-professionals. I think the situation is changing. When I read Claudia's comment, I looked at the doctoral students I had been privileged, underscore the word privileged to advise in my 40 years at Duke and University of North Carolina, and nearly half of them were women. So I think it's changing. I certainly hope so. I'm especially intrigued by how Claudia relates her fourth generation Mormon status to her teaching methods. As a sympathetic outsider to the Mormon tradition, I never would have made that connection on my own. Her faith that the classroom is a place of democratic rather than aristocratic leadership, her focus on writing as a means for students to own their ideas, her conviction that personal experience beats grand theories, which always morph anyway, her willingness to admit that she has never flunked a student and practiced great inflation before it was cool, offer a crisp new way of thinking about how the non-professional or the unsponsored sector of her life influence the professional or sponsored sector. Claudia's closing paragraphs raise a point explicitly that the other two papers raise implicitly, and this point brings all three of the papers together. Claudia tells us that for her, aligning, well, she didn't read all of this, but it's in the original paper, and I think it's very worth stating here. She tells us that for her, aligning the urban academic culture and the Mormon religious culture has been, as she puts it, the ideal way to live. It enabled her to see the differences and measure one by the other. She suggests that this arrangement was more than an alignment. It was actually a coalescence. She says, I have discovered and been drawn to topics and made them my own. They are all my extended story, additional and alternative worlds that I appropriate and colonize. There's a wonderful line right there, another wonderful line to use. Now, I propose that what we see here is something like Chalcedonian Christology. Two distinct natures in one, okay? Not two natures butting up against each other, nor even a mixture in which one shows up one day and the other another day, but rather truly something like a hypostatic union. One being, one heart, one mind, continuously suffused and empowered by distinct but overlapping impulses. She calls it a great experience, bringing the gospel and the classroom so close together. Many of the papers we've heard in the past couple of days, including these, have been autobiographical in whole or in part, and so I'll take that as a warrant for to say just a few things about my own experience that resonates with the ones that we've heard about in these three. I grew up Pentecostal, and I affectionately define Pentecostalism as something like a religious Amway movement. Okay? It is powerfully, relentlessly expansionist. So it is not surprising that I experienced religious trauma when I entered a secular college and found that most people there did not speak in tongues, and even more appalling, they didn't want to. By the time I got to graduate school, I had long since embarked on the slippery slope toward mainline Methodism. A few of you heard me tell a quip from my colleague Stanley Hauerwas, long after Christianity is dead and gone, the United Methodist Church will still be flourishing. Well, that was a slippery slope. Even so, when it came time to choose a dissertation topic, I debated whether I would write a dissertation on, well, guess what? Pentecostalism. My advisor was a broad-minded Quaker agnostic, and he was fine with that idea. But I didn't want to be stereotyped, which is to say marginalized and dismissed, as someone who's capable about writing only about Pentecostalism. So I compromised and wrote about the origins of Pentecostalism's first cousin, fundamentalism. But that didn't get me off the hook, because I'd never lost faith in the Bible's authority nor the conviction that God acts in human history. So I was stuck. I never did figure out how to resolve the tension between ahistorical assumptions on one hand and critical historical methods on the other. But it helped to write about it. It was therapeutic to put the problem in my words. Last night, Richard talked about the importance of finding the right words. Writing about it helped me see that many of the most important claims on my life were hard to square with each other. But they were simultaneously true and simultaneously there. I found, in short, that it was possible to be a whole person, albeit internally inconsistent. Stealing a line from Martin Marty, it was okay to leave the lid on the box. These thoughts bring me back finally to the reason we have gathered here this weekend to honor Richard Bushman. I'm not going to add to the encomia that have fluttered around this room for 2 days. All are richly deserved, and I do not have any more of them to toss into the mix. Rather, I want to talk about something else. Someday, an ambitious scholar will write a biography of Richard. He or she will have to be skilled in economic history, and social history, and cultural history, and religious history, and intellectual history. But if they do their job right, they'll have to write about something else: Richard's influence on other Christian historians, including me. More precisely, he influenced us not only as a scholar and teacher and Christian public intellectual, but also, and more important, as a man who had rightly ordered priorities. To take a case in point, I have learned from friends since I have been here, inside the church, that throughout his life, Richard has invested 15 to 20 hours a week as a bishop, stake president, and advising patriarch for younger men and women. Full disclosure, I've never been much impressed by theological apologetics. For every argument pro, there's an argument con. For every shoebox filled with note cards, there's a bigger shoebox filled with more note cards. Rather, I am impressed by the apologetic of a life well lived, day in, day out, through good times and bad times and all the times in between. Richard has mentored his peers in two generations of younger historians by the example of his scholarship, for sure, but also by his sense of priorities. Always busy, but never in a hurry. The courage to stand by his convictions, and humility in an academic world not known for an excess of humility. One of the mottos of the Salvation Army is, keep the main thing the main thing. For five decades, Richard has mentored us by his singular ability to keep the main thing the main thing.